to Pulp Crazy. I am Count Chocula, and I bid you welcome to this very special October episode of Pulp Crazy. With your host, he's very spooky, and his name is Jason Aiken. And his special guest today is Frank Infarter. No. Frank Schildiner, who wrote a new book about Frankenstein, and he's written all kinds of other spooky stuff, and he's going to be here to talk about all of his spooky stuff, boys and girls. So be sure to stay tuned for Frank Schildiner and the horror of Frankenstein. No, it's the quest of Frankenstein. And here's your host, Jason Aiken.
Oh, thanks for that wonderful introduction, Chuck. That was great.
It's Count Chocula.
You're Count Chocula.
Count Chocula.
I'm sorry about that.
I'm sorry, too.
This is great. This is a reunion from our former content panel at Pulp Fest.
Absolutely. Where we had to keep correcting Chuck.
Yes. Now we'll have to keep him in line for this podcast episode.
That's a lot of work, but okay, we'll try.
Yep, we can do our best.
Children of the night, what music they make. wait, no, I'm sorry. That sounds more like Kanye West. I was mistaken.
Wow, we're going deep into the devil worshipping stuff now. Whoa.
Well, there is a Kanye West connection we could throw in, but we might talk about that later when we get to the reanimator aspects. But yeah, we're here this week on Pulp Crazy. Chuck Loridans is joining me, and we're talking to Frank Schildiner about some of his horror work. Frank's written several stories, but his most recent publication has been The Quest of Frankenstein, published by Black Coat Press. And that just debuted not too long ago, right, Frank? Maybe a couple months ago?
Yeah, it came out July 31st, August 1st, around there, right at the beginning of towards the end of the summer, I mean. It was a surprise, came out of nowhere.
Oh, cool. Yeah, because I remember you had some copies at Pulp Fest, but you really didn't have them for too long because I believe they sold out pretty quick.
Yeah, I brought 6 copies and I didn't even get to put them down on the table. They started selling right out of my hands before I got even all the way over to the Meteor House table where I would have, put them down and sold, because those guys have been my buddies for, I don't know, 15 years or so at this point. And every single one of them just grabbed a copy, and then I'd keep coming to me and saying, Where's the copies? Sorry, they're gone. It's like you get to go to Amazon or Barnes & Noble or Black Oak Press.
And it's gotten very good reviews. In fact, I have a friend here who has a review for your book. In fact, he is very interested in the book when he read it, because he's in the book. Here, come here, Frankie.
Ah, book good. Frank Schildiner, good. Ah.
Thank you, Frankie. Then now go away, Frankie. Ah, see, he likes your book. It's about him. It showed he's the best shot.
Actually, it's not. It's the French from Frankenstein. So.
Oh, wait! I bring him back. Frankie, come here.
Sacre bleu! Oui, oui! Ooh la la! Good!
Well.
Okay, that's. Okay, I knew things were going to be unexpected with Chuck around, and boy, it proved right.
Yeah, maybe you could tell us a little bit about how this version of Frankenstein is different than the one that would probably pop into most of our minds. He's not the universal Frankenstein, is that correct?
Not by any stretch. Back in the 1950s, the Pulp movement, kind of the new Pulp movement, was kind of still alive in France. You got a lot of great information on that when you had on Jean-Marc Loffsier, and he, man, like did a PhD thesis on Pulp Crazy, on the French history of pulp. It's pretty amazing. At that time in the 50s, one of the writers was a man named Jean-Claude Carrier, who was writing these pulp stories, and he decided to write a Frankenstein series. But he didn't want to go the traditional route, so he made this character, he named it Garou, which is a creepy kind of name if you think about it. And he decided to take out all of the previously thought concepts, the Byron version that you saw in the Mary Shelley book, as well as the Universal Horror versions, which had the character not particularly knowledgeable or bright, not particularly articulate, afraid of fire, able to get hurt by bullets and things. Well, this version, Garul, is about almost 8 feet tall. He's got this gray, chalky skin, yellow eyes that are really very alien and very frightening, and razor-sharp teeth. And he's a fiendish mind. He's brilliant in his own terrifying way. And he has this plan that's never really revealed other than that he wanted a mate. And
Wait, it's a little-known fact. But the singer Mari Chevalier actually had a song about Frankenstein, the French version of Frankenstein, wanting a mate.
Oh yes.
It was called "Thank Heaven for Little Garous, for Little Garous, get a little lovelier every day."
Folks, he's singing, you can go get something to eat and come back later, you know. Anyway, Jean-Claude Carrier wrote these 6 books on this character traveling around doing these terrible stuff, evil, terrible stuff. And then he went on to become a screenwriter who won an Academy Award and wrote The Return of Martin Guerre and a lot of major stuff with Louis Brunel, and in 2014 was honored by the Academy, the Motion Picture Art and Science, and he got a Lifetime Achievement Award. So I was following a pretty scary legacy, if you think about it. The character was revived a couple of times through Black Coat Press, and I wrote one story called The Blood of Frankenstein that I actually read a couple of years ago at Pulp Fest, where the character is out in China, and I threw in a lot of Shaw Brothers and Kung Fu heroes and all that. It was a fun story to write. And then I asked Jean-Marc if I could write a novel, and he said, yeah, great idea. Tell me your ideas. And it worked out, and, well, I handed it in at the end of April. It took about 6 months to write, and the character was a lot of fun to write, but I wrote from a very unusual point of view. I made it him almost as the character that comes in at the end of each chapter. Instead, you're dealing with all these other monsters all over the world, so it's a lot of fun to write the character as this elemental force of evil going all over the place. So, yeah, it was quite an experience.
It's what they used to term a monster rally, and it's, as far as novels go, it's the best monster rally I've ever read. I liked it, and I've read all of Kim Newman's books. I love them, but this one kind of is a notch, in my opinion, is a notch even above the Anno Dracula series. So many great Easter eggs that some are, you know, way, not even Easter eggs, some are out, way out in the open, but there's so many nice little hidden gems in there, but and it all flows. It's not, oh, I've got to force this in there. Everything flows. It's one of the best monster rallies I've ever read.
Thank you. That's high praise. I mean, Kim Newman's kind of a hero of mine. He's an amazing writer who has more knowledge than any 20 people I've ever met, including myself, in horror movies and horror fiction. It was a monster rally. I didn't even really know it was going to become one until I wrote it. I write by the Steve King school of writing. I have the ideas, I have the characters, I have the setting, and I just sort of see what happens. And sometimes things go so different than anything I ever imagined. And I'm sitting back and say, oh, where the hell did that come from? And it's a good feeling, but it's a crazy feeling at times. You feel like there's something living in your head you didn't even know was there. One of the chapters I know Chuck particularly liked was the character meets up with a female vampire that was in the Paul Naschy Spanish horror book.
Oh, yeah.
Movies. And it's one of those things where unless you really know, you know, this series, that stuff, it kind of sneaked by and you just think she's a female vampire. It was a really amazing movie, Werewolf versus the Vampire Women. The woman who played the part was just astonishingly beautiful.
Oh, yeah. But, I mean, but, you know, even above that, the fact that Barbara Steele shows up twice.
Yeah, I couldn't, I didn't even realize it was going to happen until I'm writing this. I wrote her originally in the Vampire, there's a Vampire kind of Congress. And then I'm writing something that was going to be a kind of ghost thing, and I said, where did she, oh my God, I forgot a bit. Where did she come from? And I was writing another Barbara Steele part, and it was just so much fun, and it was a weird feeling. I had a bunch, Jason, of these weird moments when I was writing it that just, I stopped and said, I didn't even know that was in my head. Where'd that come from?
Cool.
Yeah, it was fun. It was fun, but it also is a kind of weird feeling because you don't know where your brain's going. You're just sort of letting yourself write viscerally. You know, it's just all coming out of you. And when it happens, sometimes you sit back and it's like, oh, my God, I'm crazier than I ever imagined I am.
I imagine you were much crazier than that. I knew it all along, Frank.
Well, of course you did, Bane. Of
course you did. Junior.
Just so you understand, Jason, Chuck and I realized years ago that we're the same characters from the Road movie starring Bing Crosby and Bob Hope. Because our conversations are exactly like theirs in those movies.
Okay.
So I call him Bing anytime I can.
I call him Junior.
And it goes there. It goes like that forever.
And so, Jason, that makes you Dorothy L'Amour.
Yeah, you're Dorothy, my friend.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he's indulging us. Nice. Anyway, so yeah, it was quite a book to write. I've never written a novel before. I've written a bunch of other stuff, novellas and stuff like that. But this was so out there, so different that. It was a whole new direction for my whole life. And while doing it, fortunately, I was inspired by, well, Chuck, surprisingly. I mean, surprised probably everybody here was too, that Chuck actually was part of the inspiration of this.
Yeah, he keeps a semi-nude poster of me on the wall where he writes. And I think I've influenced a lot of his more erotic stuff.
That would be the horror stuff. where it came from is Chuck, many years ago, he'd have to tell you how many. Yeah, he's pretty old, so it's been probably a long time. Chuck wrote this essay called Children of the Night that was kind of a timeline of monsters and monster movies and films on a timeline where they were all kind of connected. And
yeah, the point was I wanted, it was all part of the Wald Newton group. You know, we all were trying to, like, smooth things out. And to me, it was I wanted to have a way where you could have both the novels Dracula and Frankenstein exist in the same world, in the same continuity as the Universal films, the Hammer films, and so on into the, even incorporating the Marvel Dracula series. You know, just in a, you know, I don't include any superhero crossovers, but I just love the idea that these are all part of the same continuity, and I came up with concepts to make that work.
Yeah, and it was a great idea. It was a lot of fun to read.
And I consider, I definitely consider Frank's novel as being part of that. It fits in perfectly. I know Frank likes to say that he's got his own world, but you know, you know, when we talk about the crossover universe, it's like a great big thing, and I think it all kind of, I like to think that it all kind of fits in.
Oh, I agree with that. I just, the way it worked out, though, is that this kind of threw in my own crazy stuff in my own direction without knowing it. I wasn't planning on creating a universe, but by the end of it, I had one. I didn't even realize it.
But I think of it as being a part of the bigger universe. And that's the thing, is you can go as wild, and you know somebody like Sean Levin is going to, like, explain how it all syncs up.
Yeah, and he's better at that than all of us.
Yeah.
So
it's a brilliant book. It's a brilliant book. So much fun. Was it the you threw in one of the Hammer Mummy films that was actually based on, was it the Jewel of the Seven Stars?
Yes, it was.
Yeah.
It was. Princess Terra.
also, you threw in a character from Captain Kronos Vampire Hunter, and you, like, gave her this new twist.
I
want to use her now. I want to use the character of her, because she could still be around in modern day.
Oh yeah, definitely.
And the way you wrote her, it's like you took hints from that movie, and you gave it, you turned it on its head, and made it pretty damn relevent.
That was an interesting chapter for me. That really was, because I wanted to write a scene with a female that was a living kind of vampire, and I had, you know, I love Captain Kronos Vampire Hunters, you know, the last Hammer vampire movie, I believe, and it was so much fun with the, you know, swashbuckling styling.
Classic.
And, classic stuff, and just, and it had the hints of connections to previous movies, because the one of the vampires said she was a Karnstein. I think she pronounced it Karstein, though.
But it's close enough.
Close enough, yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's like you're really splitting hairs there. And so I'm thinking on this, and I came up with, it came to me really because I heard somebody refer to another person as an emotional vampire. And they were just meaning a narcissist who was, like, sapping your whole, you know, your positive nature out of you just by being such a negative human being, an emotional vampire. And I kept the words.
I think pretty much everybody, unless they've never left their house, has encountered that in their lives.
Yeah, that narcissistic person. Yeah, it's part of life. And somebody referred to them that way, and because of it, it kept staying. Emotional vampire. How can this go? And other people have done, like, where, you know, they try to inspire this stuff and all that. But I came up with this direction where a really very horror, classic horror-based direction from Lovecraft on how she got the power. But she's this emotional vampire, and she has this scene with Garou where she's talking about the true psychological nature of a vampire, including herself, and how they really think. And I read it at the end, it's like, jeez, I wrote a doctoral thesis on how a vampire thinks, but I did it in a fictional setting, so it's not like it's boring.
Frank, not only, you know, is it very scholarly, it's also the dialogue is very natural, and it draws you in, and you can hear this conversation going on between the two of them. I actually, you know, it's like I couldn't get enough of that chapter. It just flowed so smoothly, and you get drawn into this conversation, and you can hear them talking in those voices. I could visualize the scene perfectly as I was reading it. I mean, this could be easily adapted into a screenplay with that dialogue, with almost no change.
Wow, that's high praise. Thank you. I didn't know I had it in me. Honestly, that was one of the two moments in the book that really astonished me. The other one was the scene I mentioned earlier about the female vampire from the Spanish movie. I had this whole thing originally planned in the head, but all of a sudden it went off in this direction involving Satanism and people and, you know, what would happen if everybody in a town went over to, like, a satanic kind of lifestyle. And then this hero shows up and changes it. And a couple of people, you know, he appears in shadows and he solves the problem off camera. But it's a very interesting scene, and people have asked me, who is he? And my response is, I don't know. I didn't know when I wrote him. He just came into the story, and I did. The only time I ever heard about that was Raymond Chandler in The Big Sleep. He wrote this, one of the early things in it was the chauffeur was killed, and he never solves it in the book, and they didn't have it in the screenplay. And so they called him up and said to him, who killed the chauffeur? And his response is, I don't know, I never solved it. So it was like he had the ultimate mystery in his own mystery.
Well, it reminds me of the assistant to Eric in Gaston Leroux's Phantom of the Opera, that he kind of left that this mysterious character dangling. And it wouldn't be till years later when Jean-Marc and then Rick Lai would pick that thread up.
Yeah, they did it beautifully too. Rick Lai is such an amazing writer, and Jean-Marc, I can't say enough positive things about the man. I mean, he's single-handedly bringing to this country an entire country's worth of fiction that we would never find. Unless you have like the ability, like I believe Rick does, to translate it and read it in the original French, he is actually bringing over worlds to us that we would never experience. And
I give them a lot of my money, and I need to give them more money because I hope he doesn't get upset with me for my really bad French accent earlier. But yeah, I love Black Coach Press. I love
it really is. Great books. And it also it was really. You were there when I was on the stage second time at Pulp Fest when I was talking.
I thought you were talking about your drag queen days. I didn't know you were going to bring that up.
We'll talk about that later.
Okay.
When I was on there, I was asked about weird tales, and I kind of likened it to a kind of like a. It was like the college, you know, it was where we went to like learn how to be the pulp writer, how to be a horror writer. It was the starting place. That's kind of what Jean-Marc created in Tales of the Shadowmen. A lot of us, myself included, got our start there. And we've also gotten to say, hey, I was in a book with Brian Stableford, a writer who I admired three quarters of my life, and Michael Moorcock, who
I've
been a fan of since I was like seven, and I actually met him once, and I can actually say, you know, I'm in the same book as Michael Moorcock. It's like, you know, no matter what happens in my writing career, that is something I can always hold on to. You know, those two men right there, and John Peel, who wrote so many great sci-fi books and wrote Doctor Who novels and stuff like that. And a lot of us, like Winscott Eckert, Matt Wow, myself, Travis Hill, so we all got the start from this Tales of the Shadowmen, where you take a French character and another, and you combine them with something in another world, and you write these stories. And it's been a pleasure to write for it every year since I got into it.
Yeah, I'm definitely a big fan of Black Coat Press myself. Last couple years I've at least read one book that they've put out. Both were translated by Brian Stableford. One was The People of the Pole.
That was a great book.
Yeah, that was really interesting.
I remember it was like several years after I created my soul clone theory, my way for all these different versions of Dracula, I read Vampire City.
Oh,
which was written in the turn of the century, and it was like
Dracula.
It was my soul clone theory.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, you've read Vampire City.
Yes.
Of all that had my. I mean, it was like 100 years before I came up with it. They basically almost verbatim these vampires were creating soul clones.
Huh.
It blew my mind. It was like, because I remember I was catching a lot of flack from people in the pulp community. Not, you know, I mean, a lot of people like myself, but there were other people who said, but this is like a validation, because it was like, this is one of the, you know, the top French fantasy sci-fi horror writers, and he had basically, you know, he'd come to the same conclusions, the same theory that I did, and it was like, wow, it's validation. I mean, his verse is even stranger and even creepier. But yeah, I mean, they were creating soul clones.
They actually make an appearance in my book. I was actually a pleasure in there. What's interesting to me is that the French were so far ahead of us in terms of vampire fiction and stuff like that. It's mind-boggling when you go back to read it. There are so many of these amazing horror novels that thanks to John Mark and Randy, his wife, who also is very heavily involved in this stuff, and Brian Stableford, we're getting this whole world given to us that unless you were able to read French, you could not involve yourself with. And
right.
It's amazing stuff for me, and that's how I got to Garoul. It really came through him. And it was a pleasure to write, but a lot of work. As we all know.
Yeah, I bet.
Another fun thing about, I believe it's one of the extras in The Quest of Frankenstein, is it gives a little synopsis, because it's like, I don't know if they're ever going to get around to translating all of the French Frankenstein novels, but there is a really nice little synopsis of each book. Am I right?
You're totally right. When I was writing, almost done with the book, John Mark said to me, would you mind if I wrote the introduction and I can write on the thing? And I said, of course, I was hoping you would. I mean, and he was able to give these summaries in great details, not only about the writer, but about each of the novels that are very, very hard to get now, apparently. I asked him about that because I did want copies. And
even if you got them.
Yeah, what can I do with them? They'll sit on the shelf.
Right.
I can't read any.
I mean, the covers. I mean, it's like I'm looking at his website for years and seeing these beautiful covers, and now it's like, okay, now I know. Now I have an idea of what's going on in them.
Right.
And it sets the stage for your story before and after.
Yeah. He didn't have those summaries for me until after it was written, but. Fortunately, he is an amazing editor. He's just a spectacular editor, and he's a tough editor. So he made it very clear, this is certain lines you got to stick to, you know? And actually, that made it better, because if you have certain limitations, sometimes you're able to better expand on what you have, rather than, you know, using too much.
Right.
And he made some corrections because of it, because occasionally I stumbled across it. But, you know, a good editor can really change a book for you. He certainly did with me. I know he did.
Cool.
Yep, so The Quest of Frankenstein, it seemed to do pretty well. So I have had a few good reviews on it. I'm real proud of that.
Speaking
of
covers.
And it's a pretty dark book.
Speaking of covers, you hit the jackpot with covers.
Nope. I have never been so happy in my life. And I have a funny story about that, actually. I handed the book in, I believe, on the 29th of April. And he's in France, so he's 6 hours ahead of us. And I handed it in at probably, you know, like 10 o'clock at night somewhere from New Jersey. And he writes me about 11 o'clock in the afternoon the next day, saying, you got it, he's really enjoying it, but he decided to stop and work on the cover, here's a rough copy. And he sends me this Mike Hoffman cover that looks right out of Frazetta, with the name The Quest of Frankenstein by Frank Schildiner. And I'm sitting in my office, and I am absolutely speechless, because it was one of the most amazing covers I have ever seen. And I've had people tell me, I don't even know who you are, but that cover makes me want to read your book. And I was like, oh, God, he did so. And so he had it done before I even handed the book in. So it was, wow, what a cover. Right out of Frazetta is how I saw it immediately.
Well, and just great little details. Like, I'm looking at it right now, and it's like that tie he's wearing.
Yeah.
You know, that is just, that's insane. That's just absolutely, I never would have, I do some painting myself. That never would have occurred to me to do in a million years, but it's such, it's just an incredible touch. And the woman lying there with the gun in her hand, you know, it's just so many details.
Yeah, he did. Mike Hoffman is a spectacular painter. I've seen other stuff of his, and I've been a fan of his for years. I imagined that he was going to be the artist when it came up. I was absolutely astonished. I don't think I moved for like a half hour just staring at my iPhone like, oh my God, look what I got. And then I sent it off to my wife, and she was saying, he believed in you enough to have this painting ready for you. Which, like, just showed, I mean, that's an amazing faith somebody has in you. And I hope I lived up to it.
I think you did.
Thank you. Thank you. But yeah, it was a lot of fun, and it was great to bring copies over to my friends to grab at Pulp Fest. And if I'd known it was going to be that popular, I'd have grabbed more copies and, you know, gotten more people out there. But it was great. It was a lot of fun. A lot of fun to write, even though, well, I don't have to tell you two, but it is so much work.
Yeah.
So much work.
And why don't you talk just a little bit about the Lovecraftian element. There's a important character in Lovecraft's Cthulhu mythos that plays a part in the Quest of Frankenstein. Could you talk about him a little bit?
Actually, there's been a couple. Influenced, I guess is the way to say it, by H.P. Lovecraft. Yes, there were plenty of negatives about the man as a human being, and even some of his writing. I mean, I'm not going to be one of those apologists. I'm just not interested. When the man was on, his written description and his cosmic horror is never to be paralleled. And I hadn't planned on, I didn't know if I was ever going to even use him in this. I've used Lovecraftian concepts in the past. I always do sort of my own version just because that's who I am. I don't like sticking strict to anything, plus I don't think like a guy from his era, his lifestyle, so I can't write like him, and I wouldn't try. So I was writing this scene with a witch, and it sort of became a moment where all the magic in the world that, you know, of this horror universe came from this one spot, that it was all taught and spread by his cosmic trickster, Nyarlathotep, who is like the messenger from the outer gods. And he has like 1,000 different names. And one of the pleasures of writing that character is, you can't go wrong if you add 2 or 3 versions of the name yourself, because he changes as whatever he needs to be. I mean,
right.
Somebody put in him a bunch of years ago as like a jazz musician from the Deep South with a trumpet. Another person put in as a man with blonde hair, like white blonde hair, and, you know, pale glowing skin and white robe, so white men in white, or the white man, or something like that. So there's,
I think the Simon of Gita stories by Richard Tierney, I think he kind of he had him as an Egyptian deity.
That was actually originally from Lovecraft, the Black Pharaoh, as well. Nefraka. It's a character you can kind of use very easily, because unlike most Lovecraftian concepts, this being does contact humanity and deal with humanity on their own level as a means of spreading chaos.
And blind, so, idiot trumpet gods.
Yeah, you know, most of them, you're right, the most of them are like, they're so alien, you're writing about something that just looking at it makes your mind go nuts.
Well, see, that's the whole thing. If something's supposed to represent chaos, then it should never be nailed down to one thing. It should be different each time you write about it. Otherwise, it's not chaos.
And I even threw in a couple of names in there myself because of it. So you can never really go wrong using the Nihonthwar Tep. No, you shouldn't overuse it. It should be like a passing character. So I had this cosmic being speaking through this witch who has a very long lineage through fiction the way I wrote her. And that was an interesting moment because it was like, I only planned on having a witch appear, like maybe the Oracle of Delphi kind of appearance, but instead it became this big cosmic magic chaos thing where everything comes out of it. And so that was a lot of fun and very odd because I just didn't know it was going to happen, and it ended up playing later in the book. I also had two other characters from there popping in from Lovecraft. The second main character, which is probably where you were originally meant, is Herbert West, which is the French, I can't believe I said that, the Lovecraftian Frankenstein.
Right.
Kanye's cousin,
right. Yeah. the best known from the movie, of course, but not really.
But you got to give Jeffrey Combs his props.
I'm a 100% fan of Jeffrey Combs. The man is just so spectacular, and I love him.
Everything he does,
everything he does is just so much fun.
He stole the spotlight from Michael J. Fox in the Frighteners.
Yes, he did.
Every scene he was in, he stole it. He should be a household name.
And he also was spectacular in the Justice League Unlimited cartoon as the Question, as this extreme conspiracy theorist. Just some of the funniest writing I've ever heard, with Amy Akers as his girlfriend, the Huntress. Really well-written stuff and very funny. He also stole the entire series, Deep Space Nine, away from every actor every time he walked on screen.
Oh, he was in Deep Space Nine, too. Wasn't he a Cardassian?
No, he was Wayoon, the representative of the Dominion.
Okay, because that would have been too weird, him playing a Kardashian.
No,
and also being Kanye's cousin.
Yeah, well, that's true. Kardashian. Yep. You got it. Yep. Yeah, you should
see what I did there?
See what you did. And my suggestion is you put down the National Enquirer once in a while and read a book. But back to what we're saying, Herbert West is kind of the Lovecraftian Frankenstein, and he's the prime mover behind Garul's quest, which is probably what Jason originally meant, but my mind originally went to Nihonthwar. And he appears in a really bizarre scene that I didn't know I was going to write, another one of those, where he discusses the difference between his reasoning for creating these monsters and beating death and Victor Frankenstein's psychology. And I didn't know I was going to go there, but I'm not actually totally surprised because my mom is a therapist. So I was raised around psychology all the time. So it plays a lot into what I'm doing half the time without knowing it.
Cool.
It
fits within the canon too, since Herbert West was overseas serving in World War I as a physician. I think he was I just read Herbert West Reanimator maybe a couple weeks back, and he was overseas as a serving. I think he served though in the Canadian Armed Forces. And
yeah, well, they would have because they went in earlier than the United States. And he did his experiments while he was over there, but there was a distinct psychological difference between Herbert West before the war and Herbert West after the war. Before the war, he was a monster creator, but he was at least fooling himself into believing that he was trying to create good.
Mm-hmm.
That he was trying to defeat, death and do good for the world. But after the war, that kind of was gone. He was kind of just committed to just doing whatever he was doing, and he didn't care, you know, what came out of it. He just wanted, you know, it was almost this, a black and white kind of difference mentality. And it always bothered me that Lovecraft, who was so, you know, deep at times, never explained why the character twisted. Obviously, later as a writer, I realized he probably just got bored with writing it and said, hell with it, I'm going to do this. But, you know, as the reader, we can create our own little worlds. And by doing so, I said, now, here, let's find out what happened. And this story with Garul kind of tries to explain why he went from at least trying to be benign to not even bothering.
Cool.
That was fun.
Well, one of the things is kind of the dark humor in there is the fact that he's been giving this the monster has been given this list of things to do, and will show and will bring them back, and then like a year later, and then be sent off. Oh, but you got to get this thing and this thing too, and then like another year will go by, and it's like that's, to me, that's part of the humor, is that Herbert West, it's like he doesn't make a big deal about how much time has gone by, the monster's gone all over the world and gotten this stuff. It was like, okay, I got it now. All right, just send it over there.
Oh, he just saw him yet last week. You know, that was...
Right. It's a very understated humor, but it works. You know, I love that aspect of it. You know, and I couldn't help but like picture, you know, Jeffrey Combs' face when I was reading that. You know, just like, because he's so like engrossed into what he's doing at the time. Yeah, okay, just put it over there. Yeah, okay, I'll get to it later.
That's where I was really going with it. Yeah, the way I was picturing it was Herbert West is this guy who was really all about his work. And so everybody else is just like a shadow person around him. It's like you're either there to annoy him or to be used by him. Or, you know, there's nothing in between with this guy. So when Garul shows up with all these amazing ingredients as you said, it's all over the world. Probably a year later, it's like, oh, okay, you're here. Well, put it on that table and let's do this. You know, it was like this whole matter-of-fact kind of way of dealing with it. It's, you know, blasé when he's dealing with one of the most horrific monsters on Earth.
Who's just traveled the Earth.
Yeah, who just traveled the Earth.
It reminds me of like some of the classic Brothers Grimm fairy tales, or with the quest, you know, where somebody or some of the Greek myths where the hero is sent on a quest and the labors of Hercules and so forth, except they get there and it's like it's not even treated by the person who sent him on the quest as a particularly it's like he could have been sending him down to the grocery store for a loaf of bread, a stick of butter, and, you know, some milk.
Yeah, that was the intention.
I'll make the cake later.
Yeah, exactly. It was his viewpoint was like, you know, he just didn't see the monster's quest as particularly important to him. It's just a useful thing.
And the whole idea of the quest is for West to make him a mate, right?
Yes. Yeah, and while doing that, I decided to explore why he wanted a mate. I'm not going to say why, because it plays very into the character, and I hope everybody read it. But I try to sort of show that it's not just having kids that's of interest to this evil creature.
That's interesting.
Well, I tried. We'll see if it is to you. But it was fun to sort of discover, because you got to remember, everybody's a hero in their own story. Mm-hmm. You know, the reason some characters come off as believable as villains is because they don't really see themselves as evil. If you write somebody as so openly evil and almost saying, I am evil kind of attitude, you know, the twisting the mustache and all that, it bores people because it's too easy. It's too... indulgent. There's not, nobody really thinks that way. The only person I ever saw that sort of thought that way, and it wasn't for the same reasons as other people, was a man named Anton LaVey, who created the Church of Satan. But if you looked at pictures of him, he was like, oh my God, he's so scary looking, he worships the devil. If you actually watched a video with him, the man was a carnival guy. He was playing a scam on everybody, and anybody that bought it, he was kind of laughing at you. And, you know, he was kind of saying, hey, I'm evil. Meanwhile, ooh, you know, he's making money on it. Exactly. He's making money on
Floyd.
Yeah, you know, it was, that's the only time I ever saw it, and the man was laughing at you while he's doing it. You know, so everybody's a hero.
Like a lot of television evangelist.
Exactly. He was, but you know what? He was so openly silly. I once played this video. I only watched a few of them because, you know, it's still pretty unwatchable nonsense. But they show him playing a calliope because he was a carnival guy, literally. Right. And I had my wife walked in, and my wife was raised in this Catholic atmosphere, you know, Catholic school, Catholic university, and married the Jewish guy, me. And she walks in and she's like, who is that guy? And she starts laughing at him because he's so ridiculous. And I said, he created the Church of Satan. And she just said, oh, well, he was obviously just messing with people, and walked out of the room. And she was right. He was just screwing around, and it was funny as heck because of it. So, you know, when I'm writing him, I had to come up with a reason that he actually had this quest. And I had to come up with a reason that would make sense under what Carrier kind of would think. And that's kind of scary if you think about it. I mean, the man is an Academy Award winner. I was following an Academy Award winner in the same character. It's like, oof, that's not too much pressure.
Hmm.
Yeah. So, yeah, it was it's a bizarre kind of world to work in that. But thanks to JM, I got to do it.
Yeah, and it's a great-looking book here. I got a copy off of Amazon.
Thank you.
And you can also get it off the Black Coat Press website directly.
Mm-hmm.
And any other outlets that you know
Barnes
of?
Barnes & Noble has it, too. Barnes & Noble has copies.
BarnesandNoble.com?
Yep.
Oh, yeah. Very cool. I'll put I'll put links in the show notes for you on all of those.
And they make great Christmas gifts.
And Halloween gifts.
Definitely, yeah. Halloween's coming up.
Well, yeah, I always indulge in my Halloween movie festival. I watch about 10, 12 hours of just horror films.
What's on your list for this year, Frank?
The Devil Rides Out, one of the greatest Hammer movies of all time, Christopher Lee.
Yeah.
Let's see, Black Cat with Bela Lugosi and Boris Karloff.
Oh, yeah.
I love that movie because both guys are totally evil. It's just one's more evil than the other.
the chess game is just classic. Classic.
Yeah. Playing chess for other people's lives.
It's just an incredible movie. When he's walking around in his cellar looking at his former wives, only Boris freaking Karloff could get away with that.
Yeah.
Satanic right. Architect.
an evil satanic architect who sold out his superior officer, who was also a Satanist and a doctor. It's like, wow, that's nuts.
And they just the scenes between them are magic, between Lugosi and Karloff. Just absolute magic.
Yeah, they were. They really had it. Whenever they did a scene together, there was just something electric about it. It was like the only time I've ever seen those kind of things were when Peter Cushing would play with Christopher Lee. They had that same kind of electricity that would just come out of every story.
Have you ever seen the Roger Corman film, The Raven?
I love that movie.
Oh,
I love that movie. I even bought the book version of it just because it's such a riot. And I grew up around Peter Lorre's brother, who was in the movie. I lived across the street from Peter Lorre's brother.
Have you seen it, Jason?
No, I haven't.
It's an extremely low-budget Roger Corman film. Picture handsome young Jack Nicholson wearing a over-the-top Errol Flynn Robin Hood outfit playing the son of Peter Lorre.
Who is drinking very heavily and big moon face and, you know, totally bloated and strange-looking.
Oh, and when Peter Lorre introduces Jack Nicholson as his son to Vincent Price says, "Yes, I can see the resemblance."
And there was a great moment that was done. Peter Lorre couldn't be bothered to remember dialogue, which of course drove Boris Karloff absolutely out of his mind because he was a classically trained actor. But Vincent Price would play off of it. And they're in this coach that's being driven by Jack Nicholson. And Vincent Price says to Peter Lorre, "He's a fine boy." And Peter Lorre does something like, "Yeah." You know, so he just blows it off. And Vincent Price says he favors his mother. And Peter Lorre looks at him and says, "His mother favors him." And Vincent Price does this double take because it obviously came out of nowhere. It's like, "His mother favors him." It was just like totally hysterical. Like, it's this funny magic movie that they did where the Raven is almost unimportant to the story. It's very, 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 very funny stuff with Hazel Court and Boris Karloff and Vincent Price and introducing a young Jack Nicholson who it's just such a pleasure to watch that. I saw it the first time when I was 11 years old, and I used to get insomnia, and I snuck out of my room down to the basement to watch TV because I couldn't do anything.
Oh, and screenplay by Richard Matheson, by the way.
Screenplay by Richard Matheson. And I watched that and just could not get enough of it. And then here's the funny little trivia part of it. There were 3 days left to shooting, so they still had Boris Karloff under 3 more days of shooting, even though the movie...
And there was one more day before they tore down the set.
Right.
The cast set.
So what they did was they threw together this really stupid movie called The Terror with Jack Nicholson and Boris Karloff, who had to do all his bits in one day. And they threw this movie together in no time, and it probably cost them 10 cents to do. And it looks like it, but it made them a fortune because it had Boris Karloff in it.
I think I've seen that one. Is that where...
That was a more serious film.
Yeah, is that where there's like an older lady that's kind of like a witch, and Karloff's kind of... Well, his character, he's not really the Baron, but he's pretending to be the Baron. Is that the
it's
one?
It's more of a ghost story. It's like Jack Nicholson sees a ghost on the beach.
I've seen that one.
Yeah. It's not much of a movie, but it was all because they had that extra little moment left, and Roger Corman was just a genius at making movies really fast and making a lot of money on them.
Well, a great movie to watch as a double feature, though, a great movie to watch as a double feature with The Raven that we were just talking about, is the I think it's called The Comedy of Terror, and that's like everybody from that cast and Basil Rathbone, and it's brilliantly funny too. It's Vincent Price and Peter Lorre play
undertakers
who only have one coffin. so after the funeral,
dump the body and run away with the coffin. And and Vincent Price is this this drunken, mean son of a bitch, and he's married to Boris Karloff's daughter, and Boris Karloff was the owner of the this funeral home.
Completely senile, doddering old man now.
And he keeps trying to tell him he's going to give him his medicine, but it's a bottle of poison through the whole movie. And actually, there's an actress in it that's famous for having one of the stupidest names. She was this very busty, lousy actress who called herself Beverly Hills. And she has a brief part in it as, I think she was a rich guy's wife or something. I don't know. It's like, I haven't seen it in years, but it's a very funny movie. The same cast, basically. So those are, yeah, so far what I'm seeing in the horror list. I haven't totally formulated the list, but I seem to be going more towards evil people.
Well, one of the movies that I want to see again, inspired by reading your book, and I saw these about 20 years ago maybe, and I'd like to watch them again, and I saw that there's a really nice set of all the movies is the Blind Dead series. I haven't seen that in a while. That figures into your book, and the fact that you have that and freaking hopping vampires, Frank, is just wow. I love this stuff. I love the, you know, I kept waiting for a mention of the one-eyebrowed priest.
I wanted to put him in, but I just couldn't figure out how to do it.
Right.
So I didn't want to change. But yeah, I don't know if you've heard of these movies, Jason. The Blind Dead are these series of horror movies made in Spain. Spain has a very interesting view on horror, and they had these Templars who were murdered, and their eyes were sort of picked out by the crows, and they come back as these revenants, and they're really evil, terrible creatures, skeletons with like no eyes, and really they're frightening movies. The first time I saw it, it scared the crap out of me, so it never really left me because of that, and I was able to use them, and I had a lot of fun putting them in. The Hopping Vampire is right out of Chinese movies, which I'm a martial arts instructor in real life, but I've been a fan of martial arts and Chinese movies of different types for many years, and there was a series called Mr. Vampire. I love how I pronounce it with my Queen's accent now that I hear it. Anyway, Mr. Vampire was with these hopping vampires called Jiangshi, and the Jiangshi were really terrible, evil, frightening creatures who they didn't walk or run, they hopped. And that's one of the reasons that if you see a Chinese door at times, sometimes it's built in the middle of a wall, and there's like, you have to step through a gap, that was to keep the Jiangshi out. That's what I've read. I could be wrong, I'm not a Chinese anthropologist, but that's what I read, and that's what they told me, so I'm going to just go with it, because I like the idea. So this man named Lam Ching Ying, who was a stunt coordinator, he worked with Bruce Lee in Enter the Dragon. He was an amazing martial artist in real life. He played this priest called the One-Eyebrow Priest that Chuck mentioned. He was this Taoist priest who would only have one big long eyebrow, a unibrow, and he was the big hero that would save the day. And poor Lam Ching Ying got stuck doing these movies in 100 different versions of it for like the rest of his career. They even tried to do an American version. I don't know if you know that, Chuck.
The strangest thing I've heard, and I've always had just a bizarre fascination with wanting to see this, is that I heard that they did a crossover with Mr. Vampire and The Gods Must Be Crazy.
Yes, I saw that.
Does that really exist?
Yeah, the original Nishao of the Bushman was in it. Yeah, I saw that.
Was it really a crossover between those movies?
Sort of, yes, sort of, no. You know, it had some of the trademark humor from The Gods Must Be Crazy and some of it. It wasn't well created, but I did see that, yeah.
Now, one of the things after reading your book that I couldn't help but wonder what would happen in a kind of like a fantasy fill-in-the-blank versus fill-in-the-blank is the Blind Dead can only come after you if they hear you, right? You got to make a noise. Right. And the vampire, the hopping vampires, can only find you if they hear you breathing.
Right.
Imagine a bunch of each of those being in the same area.
Oh, that's something I hope to do one day. No, Bon Jovi.
Oh, so you thought of that already?
Oh, yeah, definitely. That's when,
and
when I wrote
throw
that.
Throw Santo and Blue Demon into the mix, and you got a story.
Well, let's bring it back, and we'll talk a little bit about Frank's collection that came out from Pro Se Press. I believe it was... Was it earlier this year, Frank, that First Seas and Other Tales came out, or was that last year?
Later last year. It was First Seas and Other Tales. Yeah, that was a series of short stories I wrote over the course of time, one of which was the story that actually made me believe I should keep trying to write. It's a short story from the point of view of like a probation officer in an urban fantasy world. Before urban fantasy even existed, really. I wrote it on a whim, and I sent it into a contest for New Jersey Horror Writers, and I won second place, which I believe I got $25 for, which cool. At that time was very good because I didn't have a cent to my name. So that probably paid for our food for like a week and a half to 2 weeks. And that made me convinced I should just keep trying, and I don't think I got another success until I hit my 40s. So it was a kind of a series of short stories I wrote in all different pulp environments. First Seas is a sort of occult detective story, briefly, more action-based. That was done as a bet. I think it was Victor Milan, the writer, who's a Facebook friend of mine and such a great writer, too, who said something along the lines of, there's no real, like, short stories anymore. He misses those days. And I said, you know what, I'm going to write one. And I put it up, and he loved it, or so I think it was him, but I might be wrong. I hope I'm not, you know, using his name wrong. And that was one story. The character is Captain Jason Seas, and he is a kind of a cult sea hero.
Did you name him after me? Was I an influence on that naming by chance?
Of course. You were the inspiration.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah, you're what, 6'6", blonde hair, right? That's you, right?
Yeah, to a T. You've seen me at Pulp Fest.
Yeah, absolutely. And I have another story that takes place in Roman times, and that was a really bizarre one to write. I discovered later in life I like Roman history before they, got to the empire and emperors and all that. It was very much a world that's almost like a big soap opera. It was very crazy kind of
world. The problem was he wrote it in Latin and no one can read it.
Well, yeah, and I don't speak Latin, so I don't know if I can read it either. And I wrote a couple of stories for JM. He took over this comic universe, and it has a very deep series of characters in the horror and fiction. And I grabbed this one hero who was a former gunfighter who was secretly a kind of a Merlin / Kwai Chang Kane from Kung Fu kind of character. So that was fun in a couple of...
Oh, is that there. That Storm Shadow?
Yep, that's him.
Okay. I wanted to ask you about that. It seems like in the story he's pretty ancient, and you even mentioned that he's a viceroy of Mu.
Yeah, he was a very... apparently, in this series of comics... he's part of a people called the Twilight People, who basically encompass all of the dark things, like vampires and things like that in the world. And I never
not shiny, glittery vampires.
Not shiny, glittery vampires.
Twilight.
I know. I should have explained. Thank you, Chuck. You saved me. the Twilight People, meaning the darkness. Not shiny, glittery. We won't go there under any circumstances. And he was a very powerful wizard of this world. And he and his brother were exiled by the usurping king. and he's also an advisor to the ancestor or son of the dead king, who's, I believe, called Dirk Demon, or Dick Demon. I can't remember off the top of my head right now. And
good Lord. That's got to be one scary David.
When I was saying it, we're going to go with it. I had Chuck around me. You got to go as slow as you go.
He said Dick Demon.
Good heavens, this is a family show, guys. Come on.
His name is probably Richard. I don't know where your brand's going, buddy. His name is probably Richard. The character, I sort of write him in this Kwai Chang Kane kind of way, where he's traveling around the world and dealing with things, and it's been fun. He's a fun character to write because, you know, there's a lot of history I don't even know about, so I could really kind of go nuts with it on my own. And I had a lot of fun with the two stories I did there. So I wrote those for JM, and I think they were printed originally in French. I have a lot of stories that were originally printed in French, and he sends me copies of them, and I look at them, and it's like, okay, I wrote this, but I don't know a word I said. So there was that.
There's two Storm Shadow stories in First Seas. Mm-hmm. Okay, I read the first one. I haven't gotten to the second one yet.
Yeah, there's another one that's a kind of shorter story called The Diner Showdown that I think I must have been in a John Woo kind of mood when I wrote it. That's all I'll say. I think I was in a John Woo gunfighter mood when I wrote it.
Cool.
So I had a little bit of fun there. And then I know I wrote also a story with a Templar.
Yeah, you've got you got two stories about, it looks like, two different knights.
Yes. One takes place at the time of Henry IV, the Greater Samson. And
that's with Sir Richard Farnsworth.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
He's a knight hospitaller. Is that the right way to pronounce
that? Yeah, he's a knight hospitaller who has been brought home at the time of Henry IV from being a hospitaller, because the backstory sort of is that most of his family died from different things, and he was like the youngest son, and he's been brought back to inherit. And, you know, I don't know what people thought of it, so maybe I'll write more of it, maybe I won't. You know, it's one of those kind of situations. The other was a character called the Templar. His name is Grave, and that takes place in Ireland. And he has a partner who's a nun, and she's definitely not your common nun. Hey, she flies, Chuck. Really, I believe me.
Sister Anna.
Yeah. Yep. She was a crazy character I created there for that. I decided to see how scared. I went to a Catholic university, even though I'm Jewish. I went to a Catholic university, and nuns are pretty formidable ladies when they choose to be. And doesn't matter what your religion is, these can be some scary ladies when they try. And I decided to have some fun with that. I had some fun with that. So yeah, it was enjoyable book to write because it was a lot of short stories. You know, I wanted to see how I could expand the new pulp medium, because most people that write new pulp these days go for the action heroes, the hero pulps, and there's so much more to it. And in that vein, there's coming a book coming up, I believe, at the end of October, called The Legends of New Pulp Fiction, and 62 writers. We wrote short stories in it. I'm one of them, and it's all different genres, and pretty much every genre of pulp except romance. It's being done as a fundraiser for Tommy Hancock, who's had some health problems, organized by Airship 27, Ron Fortier. And by pure chance, it's 62 writers and 38 artists. So 100 people involved in this.
Cool.
Yeah, I wrote a Secret Agent X story. I know Derek Ferguson is in it. He's a spectacular writer. I believe when Scott Eckert wrote a Green Ghost story. I think Paul Bishop, who's another spectacular writer, is in that. There's just a lot of people there. And So it's kind of a great cause to write for, and it gives a chance to, you know, write different mediums of new pulp, Western, sci-fi, weird Western, et cetera, et cetera. So that's what I was trying to do in my own small way in First Seas.
Yeah, I've read, let me see here, 5 of the stories in there, and I really enjoyed them, especially the ones about the two knights. I was really interested in Sir Richard Farnsworth's sword to Zona. That really got me interested. And for Grave and Sister Amy, for that story, correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems like that was a little bit inspired by Captain Kronos' Vampire Hunter as well. They go up against a different type of vampire, right, in that one?
It had definitely. I'm always influenced by Hammerhar. I mean, everything. I grew up watching that as well as reading, you know, the traditional horror books, but you didn't have as surely as many as we do these days. So Hammerhar was very influential on me as well, because it was so different from the Universal horror. Now you see, the Universal horror, I saw all of them in over the course of 2 weeks during a spring break. We had a library, and they had us during the spring break. All the kids were allowed to come for free and watch these Universal horror movies. And I got to see all of them in order. And the guy who was in charge sort of mixed them up at times so that he kind of saw them as like one big story. So for many years, the Frankenstein movies, for example, I couldn't really remember the names, because to me it was just one big story. So I had to like kind of be reminded, okay, Son of Frankenstein is when the monster is pushed into the pit. So I'd seen all of these, and they are just wonderful. I love them. And then on Creature Feature, the TV show was called, they started showing the Hammer movies. And I don't know, Jason, if you've ever seen the Hammer movies, they're so starkly different.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I've seen about maybe half a dozen or so of them. They've all been pretty good.
Yeah, to start with, the Hammer horror movies, the women are spectacularly gorgeous.
Yep.
I mean, they would get these actresses who from all different countries in Europe, and some of these actresses were some of the most beautiful women in the world at the time. It really resonated with me, and I always try to remember that. So when I was, whenever I write these characters, I'm always going to be influenced by the Hammer version, because the females in the Hammer stories, with the exception of the Universal movie Dracula's Daughter, the women were so much more vital and real and interesting and gorgeous. I mean, there were some very beautiful women in the Universal movies, but they were usually just almost like props. They really weren't very important to the story, or they were there to scream or to be carried away. That was it. Whereas some of these females were actually the drivers of the plot. Ingrid Pitt, for example, in these lesbian vampire movies of the Karnstein series, was the driver behind the story. So, you know, it was more interesting to me. And so, yeah, I was affected by that. And Sister Amy, I think it was Amy or whatever, she was definitely influenced by Carolyn Monroe.
Well, it's like I was telling you about watching Blood from the Mummy's Tomb. I think that's based on a Bram Stoker short story.
Yeah, Jewel of the Seven Stars.
Right.
She appears in the book. She appears in the West.
And Valerie Leone, she carries that movie. I watched that on... I think Turner Classic Movies last year had all the Hammer Mummy movies. And yep. I think that's the best one. And heck, I think she carries the whole thing just like on her performance in it.
Yep.
Definitely. She was a spectacularly beautiful and a decent actress too for those kind of movies. I mean, kind of based my version of the character on her. So I had a lot of fun there too. So the Hammer Horror will probably always be a very affecting to me because of that, because they were able to add a kind of desire to live in that world that you wouldn't get from most horror movies, because even the peasant girls, the ones who were just working the fields, working these insanely beautiful girls. It's like growing up, it was like, oh boy, this is good.
The quality was so good that, you know, even the things that kind of made you flinch a little bit, because, like, well, I think it was the first Frankenstein movie where Peter Cushing played Dr. Frankenstein. He was supposed to be playing Frankenstein is like almost a teenager.
Yes.
And Peter Cushing was already in his 50s. And it was,
he was engaged, but he was having an affair with the maid, or, you know, it was like, you're watching this stuff, and it was just such a more interesting universe where in the opposite sense, I love Son of Frankenstein. It's one of the great Universal movies, and one of the last times you see Boris doing the part. One of the things that always kind of made me wince was Basil Rathbone's son, Peter Frankenstein. Even as a little kid, I just kept wishing he was thrown into the sulfur pit, because it was just... I cannot handle anything that is supposed to be cutesy. I never could.
But see, that was the thing. The springboard that I jumped off of to do my whole Children of the Night monster stuff was in the first incarnation of our writing group, the Walt Newton writing group. Mark Brown, in the first series of articles, wrote The House of Frankenstein, and he had come up with the theory that that little boy from The Son of Frankenstein grew up to be Peter Frankenstein from Young Frankenstein, played by what's his name? Blazing Saddles, married to Willy Wonka. What's his name? Go on.
Gene Wilder.
Yeah. When he made that connection, that little boy, little curly haired boy, grew up to be Gene Wilder. It's like, yes, that just fits. And
I always thought it fits.
And I took it from there. And I was like, okay, that's brilliant. And it was like that. I used that as a template. For Mark Brown's initial work. I mean, I wouldn't have done it without him. You're talking about, you said I influenced you. That's what influenced me. I thought that was absolutely brilliant. You know, him making that little boy. He didn't include the hammer stuff in his. So I jumped to it from there. But there's that original article on Wynn's site, The House of Frankenstein, that our friend Mark Brown wrote, that started it all. I thought that was absolutely brilliant, having a little boy who said, well, hello.
Yes.
And we're talking about Bela Lugosi. Bela Lugosi as Igor is absolutely brilliant.
Definitely one of the great characters of all time. Yes. Great stuff. The problem is that even as a kid, I just had never handled those kind of kids. I was always the one who, like, was always thinking, like, the little rascals. It's like, okay, push him in the mud. Just get him out of my way. That's how my brain went.
Go back to something. There's, like, an important horror genre-related story that Frank wrote. It's one of my favorite short stories that he wrote that nobody's brought up yet, and that's the big black scorpion.
Big old scorpion.
I love that story. That's one of Frank's first love letters to the horror flicks.
No, that's true. That's what it was.
Talk a little bit about that, Frank. I love that story.
Well, I'm a lucky guy in the sense that I had parents who really liked old movies of all kinds, and one of the things they introduced me to when I was little was the old 50s, 60s sci-fi movie. And so I grew up watching them, you know, the great giant ant movie and Godzilla and all these things.
Gila Monster
and the Black Scorpion and all these movies. My parents would say to me, you know, during a rainy day, because it's the only time you're inside to watch TV, come here, you got to see this one. They'd sit me down and I'd end up watching, you know, for the first time I'd end up seeing, you know, Invasion of the Body Snatchers or something like that. And I always loved the giant monsters, you know, the Godzillas, the giant ants, the giant insects. All that stuff was always just to me the coolest stuff. Earth versus the Spider, which always cracked me up because they have the dead spider and they're having a dance right in the same room as the dead giant spider, but it's not dead. That just, to me, was one of the funniest, stupidest things I'd ever seen in my life.
And always rebellious youth with hot rods.
Yes, that was always a big
part. The Blob was another one of those, with Steve McQueen.
Young Steve McQueen. And, you know, always watching, you know, the farmer from the outskirts who would be saying something's happening and they'd be the first to die.
Poking with a stick.
Yeah, poking with a stick, right. And so And, you know, you can't really do that too much anymore because everybody knows scientifically it can't exist. But you know what? I said, oh, forget it. This is fiction. Get over the whole...
Artistic license.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I'll give a...
Story's more important.
Right, and I'll give a vague sort of explanation on that it can't work that way. And I wrote this story and the point of view of a rockabilly musician. You know, very much along the lines of Elvis and a little bit of Doctor Who and a little bit of...
Silver John.
Silver John is definitely from Manly Wade Wellman, 100% in there. And all of those movies where the, you know, young greaser would be the one who would solve most of the problems when the army couldn't. And he gets to this town in the middle of Arizona, or the desert basically, called Mud Flats. And one of the first thing he sees, even though this is the desert, Mud Flats, ridiculous, I know, he sees this giant, like, minivan-sized scorpion. And he reacts like anybody would if you see a 12-foot scorpion. And this garage attendant looks where he says, I don't see anything. He said, I don't see nothing. And so he goes into town and finds out the true story behind why there's this giant scorpion and why nobody is like, you know, everybody's pretending it doesn't exist. And it really was my kind of love letter to the old 50s atomic movies where if you're caught in the fallout, you didn't catch, you know, cancer, you grew to be 50 foot tall. That kind of stuff, you know, the fun of the movies, the running joke for me was, you know, they had the amazing colossal man, why didn't they introduce him to the 50-foot woman, you know, things like that.
My favorite was the fact that when they tried to cure, I can't remember it was supposed to cure or sedate the 50-foot man, they make a giant hypodermic needle with giant numbers and giant measuring marks on it.
I love that stuff.
If somebody can't appreciate that, then just like, you know, go live in a convent because you don't know how to have fun.
Yeah.
It's like if you get so bogged down with trying to be realistic and stuff, it's like, I've been watching the old episodes of the $6 Million Man, and if you stop and think about it too much, it falls apart, and you're not watching it the right way.
Yeah, you're right, and
you just gotta relax and enjoy it.
Right, and that was really what I decided to do with Big Old Scorpion, and Tommy seemed to really enjoy it, so you know that might happen some more too. It was just a riot to write something where with a big old scorpion, you know, a giant scorpion, and you know, getting to write from the point of view of somebody like a Johnny Cash, Elvis kind of guy, but with some scientific knowledge, I was having fun. I mean, that's what it really came down to. I was just having
In the early days of Walt Newton scholarship, and I'm not going to say his name, but there was this one guy who was always a stick in the mud. Because we were talking about the stuff that we would include and wouldn't include, and he would always say, "But the cubed square law. And it's like, shut up. I don't want to hear this. We're talking about fun fiction. A world where fun fiction can exist. Where, in my estimation, in my opinion, Tarzan and the Ant-Man did happen. Because I don't care about the cubed square law. I don't want all that stuff to happen in this world. I like this world where Tarzan can get shrunk and have an adventure with the ant people, and a guy can get hit by radiation and have to be, and people would have to make a giant hypodermic needle to throw at him. Yes. But of course, I think he actually winds up impaling the scientists themselves with the...
They certainly did. Because it was done in such a funny way, because they put a real hypodermic needle in the actor's hand and he threw it down. It was such a goofy looking moment, but I love that stuff. And I grew up watching all of these things, and you know, part of the reason I write is because if you live too much in the now, it's such a, everything is so dystopian, you might as well try to enjoy the fiction. You know, there's too much negativity out there, so I'm not about to start writing what's real, because there's enough of it out there. I read
to escape.
Right.
Read to escape because, you know, that's how I escape from the real world, is through cool fiction like Frank writes, like Edgar Rice Burroughs wrote, like Wynn Scott Eckert and Christopher Paul Carey. There's this one guy who read this really cool story about a barbarian woman. I think his name was Jason Aiken. He read that. Just stuff like that. That's what I like to escape with, is just stuff like that. I want to leave the real world for a while and go to another world. And that's what it's all about.
I agree with you. That's what I do. I mean, if I had to write about, you know, like, it reminds me actually the one time I met who created Hellboy. Brain is so offline.
Mike Mignola.
Mike Mignola, yeah. He's a great guy. He's a really great writer, and he's got a very good sense of humor. And in New York Comic Con, the same day I actually met Ron Fortier for the first time, and Aaron Smith, somebody asked him if he ever had the desire to write, you know, the great American novel, or just two people talking on a beach. And he was very polite about it, but he said, yeah, maybe if both of them are monsters. You know, it's like he just has no interest in bothering with that nonsense of, you know, you have to be the great American novelist. He's having a good time writing Hellboy. And
Well, it's like Guillermo del Toro, you know, who's made some of the most intense, moving movies I've seen, like Pan's Labyrinth.
Oh, love that.
But when he made the Pacific Rim, he said, I'm not trying to do any sort of deep message movie. I just want to do a cool movie about giant robots and giant monsters kicking each other's asses.
Yeah,
and that's what he gave us, you know, just fun.
Yeah, and that's what that's really what a lot of my writing is. Even when I am getting serious, I'm still having fun with it. I mean, I try to keep my dialogue down to a kind of a minimum for that reason, because you don't need to read me talking to you. You really want to read the setting and the world and feel it. And so when the writing comes in the dialogue, it's meant to really just move the story along a little faster. That's it.
But Frank, that's what I was talking about earlier. When you have the scene with Karnstein, it's like, it's a break in the novel from all the action.
Yeah,
and it's this wonderful it's a little jewel box of a dialogue scene.
It's
welcome.
That's really what it was meant to be. It's meant to really try not to be indulgent, but try to move the story along. But at the same time, I was able to, without knowing I was going to do it, I was able to kind of work mentally on the true nature behind what a vampire really is when you get past all of the trappings of power and teeth and the whole routine.
Yeah, what is a metaphor for, you know?
What they really are, and getting past also the Victorian rape fantasies and nonsense like that too.
Thank you. Yes.
Yeah, I get kind of crazy about horror these days, because it's, at this point, it's very, there's a lot of it that's very self-indulgent. You know, Stephen King doesn't do that, but a lot of people do this thing where they're trying to put their stamp. This is how I think a vampire should be written, and how I think this. It's like, you know, get over yourself. Everything's been done before. It's like, you know, you're not going to rewrite anything. You're not remaking the wheel. Just get over yourself and try to write a story and see where it goes. So with that in mind, that's why when the three of us were on stage and I mentioned Clive Barker, you know, he wrote his sequel to Hellbound Heart, and it was just awful. Just like, I love the man's writing, but he just was so offline on what he was trying to do. It's like the story didn't make any sense. The characters no longer had any reason for doing anything. It was very self-indulgent. So it's like telling people, just avoid it. You know, go back to his early stuff and you'll enjoy yourself more. So that's where it was going. And actually, Tommy Hancock always tells me he doesn't consider me a horror writer, because to be a horror writer, you really got to write grossness and all that kind of stuff. I don't think I did much of that.
You're just a natural born storyteller, Frank. Like Ray Bradbury, you know. Ray Bradbury, you know, you can't pigeonhole him as a sci-fi writer. He was just a storyteller.
Yeah,
and I think
I'll always say I'm no Ray. He was the man.
Well, no. What I'm saying is that you could pretty much write in any genre. I just think you've just got stories you got to tell, and it's that simple.
Yeah, I never know where they're coming from, I'll tell you very honestly. Like I said at the beginning, which was quite a while ago now that I think about it, I write from the Stephen King school, where I have the idea, I have the characters, and I sort of see where they're going to go. I don't know where I'm going to take it, and it never goes where I think they're wrong. Never.
Cool. And while we've been talking about First Seas and Other Tales, that was published by Prose.
Yes.
You can get it on Amazon, I think in both print and ebook.
Yes.
Is that on Barnes & Noble too? Do you know?
I believe it is. Yes, it is.
Okay.
It's in Barnes & Noble. Nook and print as well.
Cool. And you mentioned the Tommy Hancock benefit book that Airship 27's putting out. Do you know the particulars on where that's going to be available? Was that going to be on Amazon, or
that's
should we?
That's going to be on Amazon, definitely.
Okay.
That's called The Legends of New Pulp Fiction.
Okay.
It's going to be a magnificent. So many of my favorite writers, and it looks like it's going to be a great lineup.
Yes, 62 people. Actually, Ron told me that he had to cut off people after a little over 24 hours, because people were volunteering, and the book is already going to have 62 stories in it. And I believe they're hoping to have it done by the end of this month.
Oh, cool.
I have never seen any type of industry where there's different companies all help each other. I think that is just the coolest thing in the world. It's a beautiful thing. All these guys read each other's stuff and encourage each other. And the New Pulp movement's a beautiful thing. It really is.
Yeah, there's definitely a difference in the treatment of other writers than I've seen in Pulp, New Pulp. We tend to be a more encouraging group, I guess you could say. I mean, we really, there's not that cutthroat behavior you hear about so often in the publishing world. People aren't really attacking each other or
Well, because they're doing it for the love. They're not, because, you know, no, I'm not saying that couldn't happen, but, you know, we're all working regular jobs. Everybody's got, you know, regular jobs. Nobody's quitting their day job yet. And, you know, it is like they do it for the love of it. If somebody, you know, gets a movie deal or something, that would be spectacular. But everybody does it for the love of it. And because they don't want to see the printed word die out. It's a labor of love. And to me, that's what all art should be. You know, if you can make a living at it, that's cool. But it's, you do it because you love it. You absolutely love it.
Yeah, I agree with you. That we all have our day jobs, but this is what we do, and we try to indulge it as much as we can and try to spread it. So there's a lot of positive encouragement from everybody in the business, no matter where you're from. So I really am glad to be part of this group, and I'm glad I got in fast enough to be one of the 62.
Cool. Yeah, I'll put a link to the show notes to Ron Fortier's flight log. I'll just put a link to that, because that's probably where, you know, all the big particulars are gonna come out of, since he's publishing the book at Airship 27. So I'll stick that in the show notes. Anything else you got in the fire, Frank, that you could talk about?
I'm gonna be in the next Tales of Shadowmen. That's coming out probably in December, and that's a lot of fun. I don't remember who's going to be in that one, but I write a ancient alien story that involves Doctor Who aliens as well. Are thrown old fashioned Doctor Who aliens are in that one, so that was good. And I have from Pro Se a couple of short stories that'll be coming out. One is a character that I wrote with Jay Piscopo, who's absolutely one of the best writers and artists in the business. And yeah, and it's a public domain superhero known as the Iron Skull, who didn't appear for very long, and he and I had a lot of fun creating this very crazy universe. It's very unique. It's more like if William Burroughs wrote a superhero universe without sex, really. No, none of that's in there. But it's very, very bizarre and very unique direction. Don't know how the heck I got there, but it's there.
So you're saying it's a semi-naked lunch?
Yeah, semi-naked lunch, basically, yeah. And
No frontal nudity lunch.
No frontal nudity lunch. I like that. And I created a cult hero, kind of a Walt Newton type character. It's not officially in their universe because it's not. I never really tied it too hard. Called Johnny Rich. That's involved in a 1960s spy occult story. And he has a partner who is very much along the Walt Newton lines, who is this spectacularly beautiful Asian woman named May, who, if you listen to Johnny, she's the biggest chatterbox on earth, but she never speaks. She says a lot, and she's definitely no servant, but she never actually uses words to say anything throughout this whole story. And it's very much along the lines of Dennis Wheatley from, like, The Devil Rides Out meets John le Carré, the great spy writer of all time. So that was quite an unusual story, and that's being edited actually as we speak, so we'll see where that goes. It also has a little bit of the old TV show The Avengers in it.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so with Patrick McNee and Emma Peel. Great stuff. So those are the things that are happening, that are coming out. I'm writing another Thunder Jim Wade novella, and I have things that I'm discussing with people. This one is a very Lovecraftian story.
Oh, cool.
Very, very, very Lovecraftian. Because I took Thunder Jim Wade as a Doc Savage knockoff that wasn't particularly well written, even though the writer was was one of the best horror writers in the business, I kind of made him into this character who only adventures in these ancient evils. And it's a great setup. We'll see what happens with that.
Cool. Any plans for more Garol stories?
Well, you know, we're talking. JM and I are talking, and we'll see what he says. It's all on him. You know, if he wants more, I'll keep writing them. It's, you know, that's what
you mentioned. You were going to do the one called Girls Just Want to Have Fun. That was,
I was waiting for him to go there. I was hoping he wouldn't, but I had a feeling since, you know, the beginning of this that somehow he was going to get out there. And, well, you did it, Bing. You found your way to get it in there.
Hey, just trying to help you out there, Junior.
What about you, Chuck? What do you got going on?
I'm still trying to finish my story, my monster story, the Bath Mat of Dorian Gray.
Cool.
I've gotten a couple more chapters written on it, but I just, you know, I just got to get back in that, just got to get back into that mindset of just writing. But I think it's going to be fun. Then I got to find some place for it to be published, and then I'll be able to come on your show and like talk about how cool I am.
Cool. Is it
a very short conversation?
Is it a short story, novelette, novella? What are you thinking?
It's probably going to be not a super short story, but not a novella either. I think it fit nicely in an anthology of stories.
Cool. Sounds good. Well, guys, thanks for being on Pulp Crazy this week. I appreciate it.
Oh, pleasure, man. I mean, I just didn't realize it was going to go 2 hours.
Oh, no problem. We had some good stuff. Had some good stuff in there.
My friends, we are all interested in the future because that is where you and I are going to spend the rest of our lives, whether we want to or not.
Wow, you got Criswell in there.
Yep.
That's impressive. You got Criswell in there.
Events like this will affect us. Future events like this will affect us in the future.
Wow, you did Criswell.
Nice.
You got Criswell. I didn't think he could put that in there, but he managed it.
Well, everyone, thanks for listening to this week's episode of Pulp Crazy. I'd like to thank Chuck and Frank for being guests on the show. And I hope you had a good
Indubitably.
Well, hope you guys had fun listening. And
I bid you good evening.
And we'll see you next time.